I want to make sure that all of us know the scope of this talk. I'm going to talk about GPUs, computers with GPUs, and servers and clusters that have GPUs inside of them. So the purpose of this talk is showing you the result that we have achieved in our research group. We have been working on this for several years, and now we have very nice results. So what I'm showing you in this slide is this plot. What is this plot? This plot is the execution time and also the throughput for three different workloads that we have run in an 8-node cluster. Each of the nodes in this cluster has one GPU. Here we have the characteristics of the node. It has two sockets with IV bridge, and each node has a Tesla, NVIDIA Tesla K20. So we have three different workloads: small size, medium size, and large size. This is about half an hour, more than an hour, and you can see in green is the execution time using traditional CUDA and SLARM. It takes about 200 minutes. What I want to show you is how we have achieved moving from this performance, from this execution time, to this one. From moving from this one to this one, we are just executing exactly the same mix of applications. We have run a mix of applications made of LAMPS, GROMAX, GPU Blast, and mCUDA MEME. So in this way, executing CUDA, or executing the application that uses GPUs with CUDA and with SLARM, we are achieving these execution times and this throughput, which is about 1.5 jobs per minute. But with the technology I'm going to show you today, with our proposal, we are reducing execution time almost by half, and therefore we are increasing throughput almost doubling it. So let me show you how we have achieved that. For some, first I will show you which is the problem, according to our point of view, which is the problem with current GPU-enabled clusters. So once we have identified the problems we have, then I will show you how to remove those problems, and then how to engineer the solution for removing those problems. And finally, I will show you some performance numbers that will be the same as I showed you before, but with some more details. So, which are the problems? In order to understand the problems, we need first to understand which is the nature of the GPU clusters. Here we have an example of a GPU cluster. We have several nodes, and each of the nodes have a CPU, well, there could be more than one CPU, and several GPUs. And at the end, they are interconnected by an interconnection network. That could be Ethernet, could be InfiniBand, whatever. So the main problem that we see here, or the main characteristic that we see here is that GPUs can only be used within the node they are attached to. I mean, if we execute an application here, this application will only be able to use these two GPUs, but will not be able to use the rest of the GPUs. This is something that everybody knows. This is something that everybody is used to. And everybody thinks that this is the usual way to use GPUs, and nobody has been surprised because of what I have said just now. But what I propose you is using GPUs in a different way. Let's see which is the problem that using GPUs only from the same node brings us. The first problem is what happens when we have an application. For example, we may have an application spreading these four nodes, and this application is not using the GPUs, it's a CPU-only application. In this way, this application is using all the cores of these nodes, and as it is using all the cores, no other application can be run in those nodes, and therefore the GPUs remain idle. We bought the GPUs, but we are not using them. So in this context, GPUs may remain idle for some period of time. Which are the consequences of this? First, we invested some money in buying the GPUs, and we are not using them. So the initial acquisition costs are not being amortized so fast. The second problem is that GPUs require some space. GPUs are bigger than CPUs. So if you put a GPU in your node, you will have to remove some CPUs, or you will have to have a bigger node. And the third problem is energy. Even though those GPUs are idle, GPUs when idle still take some energy. We made some measurements, and in the case of the K20, for example, the energy consumed when the GPU is idle is about 25 watts. If we have this node has a single GPU, the total idle power is about 125 watts, and from this 125 watts, the GPU is taking 25 watts. If we have a node with 4 GPUs, then you can yourself make the account in order to know which is the power we are wasting for doing nothing. One more concern: what happens with applications that are able to use several GPUs? This depends on the nature of the problem, but many problems can be parallelized in a way that if you have more GPUs, you can send more data to those GPUs and concurrently solve the problem faster. In the traditional way, we would execute the application in this node, for example, and the application would use the GPUs that are inside the node. What happens with the rest of the nodes and the rest of the GPUs in the cluster? Suppose there is no load on those GPUs. This application that may take advantage of these GPUs if the application could access them will not be able to send them data and kernels in order to execute the program faster, because the application can only use the GPUs that are inside of the same node that it is being executed. This is another concern. And then one more concern: when we run an application in a GPU, do we take all the computing power from the GPU? Probably not. I mean, if we are running HPL, for example, for sure we will take all the power from the GPU. But for many other applications, this will not be true. First, the application may present a low level of parallelism, so the nature of the application is not able to extract or to make use of all the hundreds of cores that are inside of the GPU. Also, the application will have periods of time that is executing CPU code and periods of time that is sending kernels to the CPU, to the GPU, and may wait for the execution of those kernels or may do things in parallel. But in any way, while the application is running CPU code, it is not running GPU code, so the GPU is there, stopped. Also, all of us know the problem about GPUs. They hide the latency to memory by running a lot of threads in parallel. What happens if the cores of the GPU don't have the data? They will stall. So at the end, what happens is that we have a cluster with GPUs, and we have some scenarios where GPUs may not be used, even if they are available. Some other applications that will not take use of GPUs 100% of the time. And in summary, what is happening is that we bought a costly cluster with GPUs, but we are losing GPU cycles. We don't like losing cycles. Which is the problem? What is missing here? What is missing here is that we need some extra flexibility for using the GPUs in the cluster. So what I'm going to propose you, what I'm going to present you, is a way, a software way. No hardware will be changed, we'll only add a software layer in order to increase this flexibility and take more advantage of GPUs. So, from our point of view, our ambition, in order to take this extra performance from the GPUs, consists of these two ingredients. First, we need to share the GPUs across all the nodes in the cluster, so that whenever a GPU is idle, an application running in any node of the cluster can use that GPU. So we propose to detach GPUs from nodes. And the second ingredient, once we achieved sharing the GPUs, is just the natural step. We should enhance job schedulers in order to be able to use these GPUs that are decoupled from the nodes, in order to be able to use these GPUs that are not anymore inside the node. So, for the first ingredient, what we propose is the use of remote GPU virtualization. What is remote GPU virtualization? Basically, remote GPU virtualization allows us to move from this configuration, which is the traditional one, to this one. Look, we have changed in the hardware nothing. from the physical point of view, the cluster is exactly the same. But from the logical point of view, we have detached the GPUs from the nodes, and we have created a pool of GPUs that can be accessed from any node in the cluster. So now we can run an application in any of these nodes, and then these applications will be able to use any of these GPUs without worrying about where exactly is the GPU. So in this case, we are increasing the flexibility to assign applications to nodes in the cluster. For example, how this would solve the first concern. When we send an application that is using only CPU and is not using GPU, these GPUs, in the traditional way, would be wasted. Now, these GPUs that are in these nodes are not wasted because the application is running in these CPUs, but we may send applications to these other CPUs that would use any of the GPUs. How about applications that may take advantage of as many GPUs as possible? In the traditional way, we should submit an application to this node, and that application would use only these two GPUs. If we achieve the remote GPU virtualization goal, then we will be able to submit an application to this node, for example, and it will be using any amount of GPUs available that is useful for that application. Problem. We have always a problem. Nothing is for free. The problem is that you have to send the data to the GPU. In any case, if you are using the GPU locally in the traditional way, you have to send the data to the GPU. Here we have a plot for the percentage of time devoted to data transfers when we are executing a matrix-matrix multiplication. So we can say that as the matrix size increases, the percentage of time devoted to send data across the local PCI Express link is decreased. Now we don't have the GPU at the other end of the PCI Express link. We have the GPU at the other end of the network. So this time is expected, this percentage of time is expected to be more important. So now the goal with remote GPU virtualization is, if we want to make remote GPU virtualization efficient and effective, we should keep this percentage as small as possible. We should keep this percentage as close to the original overhead introduced by the local PCI Express link. Now, let's talk about the second ingredient. The second ingredient was enhancing the schedulers so that they are able to deal with these remote GPUs. Current schedulers, like SLARM, are able to, this is a matcha technology, they are able to deal with local GPUs. This is something that they do very efficiently. But they are not able to deal with remote GPUs. So we should enhance them. And once we are changing SLAN, why not doing this? Why not enhancing a little bit more the scheduler so that as soon as it detects that a GPU, a remote GPU, or a remote box containing a GPU is not being used, then the scheduler switches off all the GPU boxes and keeps only working the GPU boxes that effectively have some workload. This way we would save a lot of energy. This is the idea. Now we have to perform, or we have to implement, the idea. First, there are several proposals for implementing remote GPU virtualization. Some of them are publicly available, some of them are not publicly available, some of them are older, and some of them use a more updated version of CUDA. So in the following, I'm going to talk about rCUDA, not only because this is the solution we have implemented, but because this is the most modern one that we know. How does rCUDA work? First, we should review a little bit how CUDA works. The basic behavior of CUDA is that we run the application. The application makes calls to the CUDA libraries, and the CUDA libraries deal with the GPU. The GPU performs all the computation and the data goes back to the application. When we have rCUDA or any remote GPU virtualization, because at the end all of them work in the same way, we have this architecture. We have a client server architecture. We will have the application running in a client node. We will have the network between the client node and the server node, and then the application is not changed, the application is not aware that it is using a remote GPU, the application, as before, is using using CUDA to send data and kernels to the GPU. But now the calls for CUDA are intercepted by our rCUDA client, which forwards all the calls and the data to the rCUDA server, and then it forwards everything to the GPU. So the client will not have any GPU, and the server will have the GPU. But the application thinks that the node where it is being executed has the actual GPU. So all the data and the computations are performed in the remote GPU. Once results are ready, they are forwarded back to the rCUDA client, which forwards all the data or all the results to the application. And the application has noted everything, has noted nothing, except maybe an increased latency, because now we are not using the GPU that we had before in this node, we are using a GPU that is farther away, and this is the actual problem. How do we provide GPUs to the application? This is very easy. In the client node, we just declare some variables. This one would tell the amount of remote GPUs we are providing to the application, and these ones tell which is the location, which are the nodes where those GPUs are located. And that's all. At this point, we will run the application. Nothing else. Regarding rCUDA, which is the network we are supporting with rCUDA? Well, first of all, we are supporting TCP/IP. We did a modular architecture, so in addition to TCP/IP, we are also supporting InfiniBand. And with this modular architecture, we may support in the future any other network that comes to the market. Which is the basic performance of rCUDA? We did some experiments in our cluster there, in our labs. Remember that we are using Ivy Bridge with 6 cores at this speed. We have GPUs Tesla K20. We have InfiniBand FDR, and also we have for these experiments a 1 gig per second Ethernet, because we are comparing the performance. And we are running in this case the CUDA SW++ application. We have a lot of data here. So the important thing is that the lines is execution time, and the bars is overhead over the baseline, which is the execution on CUDA. So it is easy to see that Ethernet has a lot of increased execution time, and the red, the yellow, and the blue one are all here together, and they present very similar execution times. So we should look at the overhead. We can see that overhead for Ethernet is a lot, but if we look at overhead for FDR and for QDR, we see that overhead is below 5%. This is for this application. Every application is different. I will present another application which overhead is lower than 1%, and what I am not presenting is that there are applications that overhead is about 10%, but these are not the good numbers we like to present. So this depends on every application. But usually the overhead is between 5 and 10%. What happens with multi-GPU applications? Applications that can use more than one GPU. We did an experiment in our cluster. We have there 14 GPUs, and here we have the data. We are executing the Monte Carlo multi-GPU from the NVIDIA SDK. We are presenting computation time, execution time, and the amount of options per second that the program is available to compute. This is the output of the program. So we can see that as the amount of GPUs increases, the execution time is reduced. With CUDA, you can use all the GPUs that are inside your node. How many GPUs fit into a single node? Usually up to 4, now up to 8. We did this experiment with a box that was able to fit up to 4 GPUs. So this is the performance, this is the execution time with CUDA. With rCUDA you see that it's similar, but we continue adding more and more GPUs and execution time gets reducing. And with the amount of options per second is the same. With CUDA we just arrive up to this amount of options per second, and with rCUDA, as we are able to provide more GPUs to the application, then the performance is increased. Here we have an application run with ConnectIV. ConnectIV has been already explained. It has two ports working at FDR speed. So we run the CUDA meme application, and here we have the execution time for this application. Notice that this is not zero. This is much higher than zero because we made a zoom in order to show better the results. So this is the execution time with CUDA, and this is the execution time with rCUDA when using Connect S3, the previous FDR. When we are using ConnectIV with a single port, we slightly reduce the execution time. When we use both ports, look, we are getting almost no overhead. So now let's talk about SLARM. We have to teach SLARM how to deal with remote GPUs. Now it is not able to do so. So we have to change the scheduler in order to be able to take advantage of rCUDA. So which is the idea? This is an example with SLARM before changing anything in the code. This is the SLARM that you can download from the server. Here we have 5 jobs, and here we have the resources that every job is demanding. So this job is demanding 2 nodes and in total 3 GPUs. So whenever it is submitted to the SLARM queues, it will be tried to be scheduled, but SLARM will look for 2 nodes, each of them having 3 GPUs. The cluster we have is this one. We have 1 node with 2 GPUs, 1 node with 1 GPU, and 2 nodes without any GPU. So as soon as this job is scheduled, we have an error because we are not able to provide 2 nodes with 3 GPUs each. Then job number 2 comes, it is scheduled, it requires 2 nodes and 1 GPU. SLARM will provide 2 nodes with 1 GPU each, and it will take this time. Job number 3 arrives, it requires no GPU, it will be placed in this node. And job number 4 and job number 5 is the same. They require some GPUs, and finally, whenever these GPUs are available, job number 4 will be scheduled, and then job number 5. This is the traditional, the regular SLARM. Which is the idea with rCUDA? Now, notice that we don't have nodes with GPU. We have detached GPUs from nodes. So we have GPUs here, and we have nodes here. We have the same hardware, but we are using it in a different way. So job number 1 arrives, it is requiring 2 nodes and 3 GPUs. We are able to provide it 2 nodes and 3 GPUs. As soon as the GPUs are available, job number 2 is scheduled, is placed on execution, and job number 3, and so on. And this is interesting. In this example, this example has nothing to do with real life, but in this example, with traditional SLARM, we were able to execute all the workload except job number 1 in time 8. With the modified version of SLARM, we are able to execute all the workload, including the first job, in time number 7. Now we can go one step further. Let's share GPUs between jobs. Now, job number 1 arrives. It requires the same resources as before, and it is placed on execution. If we are sharing GPUs among jobs, as soon as job number 2 arrives, we will share one of the GPUs between job number 1 and job number 2. Now you will be thinking, yeah, but both jobs will run slower. Yes, that's true. Both jobs will run slower. But now, later I will present you which is the result of these jobs sharing GPUs and running slower. So at the end, everything is the same, but look, now if we are sharing GPUs, we are able to run the workload one cycle before, not taking into account that these two jobs run slower. So this is tricky, but including everything in the example was really complex. So now is the interesting part, the performance. For analyzing the performance of this new version of SLARM that is able to use rCUDA, we made use of a 9 node cluster. 8 of them have a Tesla K20 GPU, and one of the nodes has no GPU, and this node will execute nothing. This node is just hosting the SLARM server that will schedule all the jobs. So all the executions will be performed in these 8 nodes. We have run a mix of three of the four different applications I mentioned before: GPU Blast, LAMPS, and CUDA Meme. GPU Blast uses a single process with six threads, so it requires six cores in the CPUs, and it is using GPU. LAMPS is using four threads in four different nodes, and is using one GPU in every node. And CUDA Meme is just the same. Here we have the execution times with GPUs, and GROMMAX. We have included GROMMAX. GROMMAX is using GPU, but in this version of GROMMAX we didn't use the GPU version. We used the CPU only version, just to disturb the other processes, just to have a workload that is more close to the real life. So in this case, every instance of GROMMAX will use two processes that will span over two nodes, and on every node it will use the 12 cores that are available in that node. Basically, this application is the one that is disturbing everything, that is using all the cores available in the system and is avoiding that the GPUs in those systems are used. And we have three different sizes for the workloads: small, medium, and large. The small size is about 70 jobs, the medium size is about 170, and the large is 330. Why these numbers? It's a long story. We try to do something different, and we finally ended with this. We are performing now improved executions with different workloads in order to get similar results to these ones, but with better workloads and with more combinations. But the interesting thing is this one. This is the plot I already presented. Now we can understand the plot. This is the execution of SLARM and CUDA. Nothing has changed. In the green bars, rCUDA is not presented, is not included, it's only CUDA. And this version of the version of SLARM using the green executions is the traditional one. And we already know these numbers. These are the same as in the previous slide and the slide at the beginning. And we also know that we are increasing throughput. And now we can do something else. Look, now we are repeating the experiment, but instead of using the 8 GPUs from the 8 nodes, we are removing GPUs. We will still using the 8 nodes, but two of them will not have any GPUs. And in these experiments, we will using the 8 nodes, but we will remove the GPUs from 4 of them. Let's see what happens. Here we have the in green, we have the execution times for CUDA and SLARM. No change at all. We have for 8 GPUs this execution time, which is the previous as before. When we remove GPUs, obviously execution time increases, and when we remove more GPUs, execution time increases more. This is for the small size of the workload. For the medium and large sizes, we have similar results. What happens when we are sharing GPUs between nodes, or between applications, sorry? When we move from 8 GPUs to 6 to 4, basically, execution time doesn't change. It's increased, but it's increased very, very, very small. We have a similar result here. Execution time increases, and also here, but the increment is not that large. Why? Well, the reason is obvious. We are sharing GPUs. So whenever GROMMAX, for example, GROMMAX was not using GPUs, whenever GROMMAX is put into execution here, it is using two nodes. What happens if GROMMAX is put into execution and is using two nodes that have GPUs? So for the experiment where we removed four GPUs, whenever GROMMAX is being executed, if it happens that it falls into nodes that have GPUs, it's invalidating, it's avoiding the use of these GPUs. So we are not using four GPUs, we are losing six GPUs. So this is the real problem. We have these other results. Here we are plotting the amount of time that GPU, the percentage of time that GPUs are allocated, the percentage of time with respect to this execution time. So the results in this slide are tricky, because all of them are not normalized to a single amount of time, they are normalized to the amount of time of that particular execution. And we can see that the amount of time that GPUs are allocated with rCUDA is increased. with respect to the amount of time that GPUs are allocated with CUDA. So this is one of the reasons why we are getting those results. But notice one important thing. This is allocated time. It's not GPU utilization. It's different. You allocate the GPU to an application, and the application can do whatever it wants with the GPU. It will send data, it will make computations on the CPU. While the application is doing computations on the CPU, it's not using the GPU, probably. But it's accounting for the time the GPU is allocated. So now what we are doing is improving these results. We are doing that now in order to plot, instead of time allocated, actual GPU utilization. So what we expect is that the difference between CUDA and rCUDA when we plot actual GPU utilization is much higher. And this would perfectly explain why we are getting these results. So, in order to conclude my talk, I would like to point you to highlight three different aspects about the use of remote GPU virtualization. First, we are used to high performance computing. That's good. But now we are proposing how throughput computing. This is not a new term. Some other researchers already accounted for this term. But what we are doing with rCUDA and with this new version of SLAR is all the GPUs are being used, all the workloads, all the applications in the workload are executing sharing GPUs, so all of them probably run slower. But even though they are running slower, let's look here, even though applications here individually are running slower than applications here, the important thing for the user is that applications enter execution earlier and complete execution earlier. So while they are executing, they are executing slower. But the user is not seeing this. What the user sees is that his jobs, complete execution much before than with traditional CUDA and with traditional SLAR. And this is what matters. So we move from high performance computing to high throughput computing. But what happens if you want your application to run at the usual speed? Well, this is something that data center administrator can choose. We designed SLARM in order to share GPUs or not to share GPUs. You can submit a job and specify that the job should not share GPUs with any other job, or that it may share GPUs. This is interesting because you may charge different amount of money to users that don't mind sharing GPUs or to users that want GPUs in an exclusive way. Also, we may talk about green computing. Now we are requiring less resources to execute the same workloads. If we are switching off nodes, which is not presented in this application, if we are using, for example, GPU migration in order to consolidate jobs into GPU boxes, GPU boxes would be something similar to storage boxes or networked storage. You just put a box in the network and that box has an storage. So we propose the same. You just put a GPU box in the network, you just attach a GPU box to the cluster, and you have this similar stuff. And also, rCUDA or remote GPU virtualization provides more flexible system updates. What happens if you have a system that doesn't have GPUs because you bought the system and you didn't think that you were going to need GPUs? Now you need GPUs. What do you do? Buy a new cluster, remove all the nodes you have and update them. With remote GPU virtualization, you just can buy a few amount of GPU servers, attach those servers to the cluster, and you have GPU computing. Or the same, you have an older cluster that is not able to include GPUs because they don't have the right PCI Express version, or they don't have the space in the boxes. You attach a few GPU boxes to your cluster, and then you can play GPU computing. And that's all. One more thing. If you think rCUDA may be useful to you, you can get rCUDA. It's working, and we are providing it for free. You just have to register in our website, and we will send you the binaries for your cluster. Why we are requesting you to register? Well, this is done with public funding, so later we have to go to the government and say, look, all these users are using rCUDA, we got more money. So this is why we ask you to register. And that's all.
Any questions?
Just any limitation on which MPI you can use?
Any limitation on MPI? As far as I know, no. The limitation is that we don't support a few of the calls to CUDA. So as far as your MPI application doesn't use any of those small amount of calls of CUDA that we are not supporting, there should be no problem. For example, we are not using the graphical commands, the graphical functions of CUDA, we are not supporting that.
So any MPI application like OpenMPI or Interface, they will work?
It's working.